A shift to a world that's no longer powered by fossil fuels likely means we're going to rely more on batteries and the metals that make them. Because land-based sources of these metals can meet the demand of a battery-powered world, private companies have turned their attention to the ocean floor. But mining the murky depths may come with a greater cost to the planet than it's worth. Terrestrial mining doesn't have a perfect record. It comes with a long list of environmental and human rights abuses, including pollution and child labor. All this to dig up raw materials like nickel, manganese, and cobalt that are necessary for our lithium-ion batteries. Some strategies for a carbon-free future depend on making these batteries in much larger numbers and using them as a power source for electric cars or a storage method for electricity generated by renewables. But another source of these materials could lie at the bottom of the ocean. Potato-sized lumps called polymetallic nodules are rich in manganese, copper, cobalt, nickel, and other precious metals, and they're found in abundance in some areas like the Clarion-Clipperton Zone that stretches from Hawaii to Mexico. In this one area alone, known as the CCZ, nodules contain more nickel and cobalt than in all known land-based sources combined. There are a few reasons why we haven't scooped up those tempting little sea nuggets. One of them is technological. Between us and them, there is a literal ocean. And getting to them is not a matter of just distance, but pressure too. The deep sea is usually defined as the water 200 meters below the surface and beyond. Every 10 meters underwater adds another atmosphere worth of pressure, and these nodules are often found below 3,000 meters. That means the machines that harvest them would have to withstand more than 300 times more pressure than you or I feel walking around on the surface. The expense and engineering that would go into a seafloor harvesting operation has long deterred anything beyond small-scale exploration. But after decades of testing, the technology to mine the ocean floor looks like it's maturing and ready for large-scale use. For example, one company, Nautilus Minerals, has developed this trio of machines. Two of them are for crushing up ore before the third collects it, mixes it with seawater, and sends it to a pump that lifts the slurry to vessels on the surface. The other thing standing in the way of deep sea mining is a lack of a legal framework. Nodule-rich areas like the CCZ are in international waters. A United Nations chartered organization called the International Seabed Authority, or ISA, has been working with 167 member states and the European Union to hammer out the rules and best practices for deep sea mining. They could agree on terms by 2021. In the past decade, though, the ISA has issued almost 30 exploratory licenses, but once the rules are finalized, operations could ramp up to an industrial scale. As companies gear up to mine the ocean, many scientists that study the ocean depths warn that mining could be environmentally devastating. Just how devastating, we don't really know yet. Because of that intense pressure at the seafloor, it's the most poorly understood ecosystem on Earth. Scientists didn't even think it could support much life beyond a few scavengers until 1977, when the first ecosystem around a hydrothermal vent was discovered almost 2.5 kilometers down. Even today, marine biologists think we've only found a tiny fraction of the life that lives in the deep. Mining could wipe out organisms before we've had the chance to discover them, like microbes that have possible uses in medicine. Many microbes actually live on polymetallic nodules, which can take over 10 million years to form. So once they're extracted, that habitat isn't coming back. The waste slurry that's dumped back into the ocean once ore is extracted could also be a hazard. If it's dumped high up in the water column, it could possibly drift for hundreds of kilometers and disrupt ecosystems far removed from the mining site. And the site itself could be scarred for years. In 1989, scientists simulated a mining operation by dragging plows across the seafloor. And nearly three decades later, the tracks are still there, and the microbe and animal populations haven't fully recovered. Some of those bacteria absorb carbon from the environment, so mining operations could set back some of the efforts to go green. It's an uncomfortable dilemma. Mining on land has a lot of known negatives, but the impacts of deep sea mining are unknown and potentially huge. A future where carbon emissions are under control could depend on having enough of these resources, but who knows what irreversible harm we could do getting them. Fortunately, we're getting better at recycling these metals, and other energy storage solutions do exist besides lithium-ion batteries. Maybe a healthy, sustainable energy future is within our reach, but it's going to require informed people making decisions and caring about what happens to a part of the planet that most of us will never see. Polymetallic nodules form as dissolved metals build up on organic materials, and they often form around ancient shark teeth. If you want an idea of just how much remains undiscovered in the ocean, check out Marin's video on 200,000 new viruses scientists didn't know existed here. Thanks for watching, be sure to subscribe, and I'll see you next time on Seeker.